Some writers, some people are like fractals. They do many different things, and from a distance they look like a chaotic pattern. But when you look deeper, there is some kind of harmony. Peter Lamborn Wilson is a writer. He has written many books, has performed all over the world, reading. Some of his writing is very poetic, but one of the main themes is a place in time can be something else than just a place in time. It could be an autonomous zone, temporary autonomous zones. Peter, that's a concept you have written about a long time ago now, 20 years, but what does that really mean?
First of all, I wanted to say something about your fractal remark. I used to call this state ambulatory schizophrenia. I don't try to put all this stuff together. If I'm interested in, at one point I realized I was interested in both Sufism and anarchism, and it didn't seem to me that this was really something you could synthesize, but I decided to heck with it. I'd just be interested. I'm interested in it. So in that way, for me anyway, these things began to come together just because I decided to be schizophrenic about it. So anyway, if that's fractal, okay. Now, on your other point, I still think that the temporary autonomous zone is a relevant idea because it happens. In other words, this is not something I invented. I always like to make that clear. I'm not like the father of the TAZ. I just noticed it. Maybe I gave a clever name or something that has now escaped from my grasp, and it's just, you know, it appears in the world now as a phrase. But that's because I think the reason why it's a good idea is because it's not my idea. It's something that happens. And this thing that happens is that no matter how much oppression there is from the state or how much monoculture there is from corporate global capital, or no matter how much boredom, no matter how much slavery, I mean, at any period in history, somehow magical community happens. I don't know how else to call it. It's not just the ordinary community, the one that you're born.
It's a community where the extra thing happens. Now, going to the deep roots of Christianity, I think Christ said, you know, when two or more are together in my name, I'm there. Now, this extra thing that one of the writers you talked about, Fourier, called like harmony, that exists in a group of people within a religious context, which happens with in Amsterdam we know the hacker groups, what happens in the Krakers, the squatter movement, what happened in Ruigoort. Isn't that another name for extra happiness, extra?
Well, I was just trying to arrive at a social idea about that. I was trying to see something in common with all those different kinds of communities, and also seeing that this was a kind of a temporary thing because it depends on a special spirit, it depends on a very high state that everyone gets in together, and that's hard to sustain in human life. You know, we don't have that many moments of exaltation and, you know.
But still, there seems to be some logic to it. I mean, if people come together for a good dinner party and the atmosphere is good and the food is good and maybe the music is good, that extra thing happens.
Absolutely, but then, you know, then everybody goes home. The dinner party metaphor is an old one. It was used by the anarchists in the 19th century to say this was their idea of how a society could work all the time. Right, that nobody makes rules for the dinner party. You sit there. You say, well, I mean, you know, maybe in a diplomatic dinner, but in a nice dinner party, you know, and no one tells you what you're going to talk about, and each person could bring some food, so no one's sure what the whole dinner would be like. You know, there's a lot of ways to introduce spontaneity within a situation where everybody's ready for it. A little wine, you know, exalted state. And you have your temporary autonomous zone for the evening. So
you say autonomous. Could you also say isolated zone?
Well, isolation sometimes helps. Also, of course, historically, like the pirate utopias, you know, you get far away from civilization, and it's perhaps easier for the spontaneity to occur. You can plan for spontaneity to emerge when you have some isolation. Now it's a question whether such isolation could be possible. You know, I mean, certainly the pirate utopia idea is very hard to sustain. I'm just talking to these guys who are making the Y-lands, you know, the floating islands on plastic rubbish. And I think that they, in the back of their minds, they have the idea of starting a new country or something based on these rafts. And I was saying, I don't think that's a good idea because the combination of corporate power and the nation state, you know, they're going to blow you out of the water. They have all the big guns. They have satellites that can see exactly where you are all the time, blah, blah, blah. Mm. You know, so that kind of idea of political independence is very dicey, very questionable now.
But are there places like...
In other words, you can't be isolated by your own fiat. You know, I am now isolated. I'm a nation state. Someone's going to blow you out of the water.
So you either have to hide or you have to find a niche somewhere. Now, is cyberspace such a place where 10 years ago people thought this would be the new utopia, the new democracy, the new place where new ideas and even revolutionary ideas could flourish?
Well, I have to say, not even 20 years ago did I say that. I never said that. People accuse me of saying that, but they haven't read the book. What I said was that the temporary autonomous zone is a place, a physical place in time. And cyberspace is not a physical place. You have interactivity, but you have no communication, no community, because the body isn't there, the nose isn't there, the ears are usually not there. Usually only the eyes are there. And, eyesight is this supposedly the noble sight because it's detached from our bodies and it's the source of our knowledge of the world and so forth and so on. But the isolation of the sense of the one sense, I think, is potentially sickening, you know, on the social, especially on the social level. And I also think that what I said 20 years ago was that this cyber thing, which I don't even know if we used the word then, could be a way to potentiate the possibility of the emergence of the TAZ through communications, right? I'm not sure that even this has been realized.
So the idea was there that you could use communication, email, and so on, to bring people together on a specific subject and in a specific mood that could lead to this. I find it, when I hear you talking about the temporary autonomous zones, what comes to mind is 1 + 1 = 3. You see, two people, and then there's something extra, and that extra is what you have tried to find, to describe in ranging from dinner parties to pirates on the high seas.
Yeah, sure. I like to quote Michel Serres, the French philosopher who talks about Hermes. And he says that whenever there are two, then Hermes arrives. He's the third. He is communication. He is the secret. He is the guest, the parasite, the third. This mysterious force, you know. And that's the... magic, if you like, of the TAZ is this the uninvited guest.
Okay. At the same time, these TAZs that you have described, apart maybe from harmless dinner parties, have been groups or situations that were seen by society as threatening. Take the pirate empires in North Africa or in the high seas the Caribbean, the communities that you describe in the 19th century. One of them was called the Phalanx by Fourier.
Sure, well, those were intentional communities in modern terminology.
They were always seen as dangerous to the present order, the political order.
Sure, if you're autonomous long enough, you get noticed and then the trouble starts. You know, and usually I find for these political or violent TAZs, the ones that achieve a large scale, the size of a city or even perhaps a region, these tend to last about 18 months to 2 years. I don't, you know, all I can say is that seems to be an organic time.